started with the CAM modeling of the sedimentation process in the hopper. Just a simple ideal settling basin where we have followed trajectories of particles, but the well, more or less the simplified method was that we were looking at a kind of laminar flow in the hopper, so very nice horizontal flow lines, and just the particle settles in that horizontal flow, so you get a very nice straight trajectory of a particle. And with this straight trajectory, say you could well estimate then the number of particles that reach the bed in time, and other particles are leaving the domain. And by well, by dividing the whole particle size distribution in several fractions, you can integrate then the settling of all different sizes and arrive at the lower integral, which determines then the settling of a certain particle size distribution. Problem is that in reality the flow is not laminar but turbulent, and it means that if you have a particle normally settling along a straight trajectory in laminar flow, due to turbulence you can have the stirring up of eddies, which transports the particle to the overflow section. Well, that's something that we like to model. So how can we do that? We are going to do that with a continuity equation, advection diffusion equation. We define, in fact, the whole flow domain in control volumes. And in every control volume, we look at the fluxes, so the rate of exchange within a control volume, because the rate of change of the number of particles in a volume is equal to the total of the sum of transport through all the sides of that volume. And we have advection, that is the particles are carried with the flow, and we have diffusion, which is in fact the mixing due to turbulent eddies. And we'll finally arrive at the advection diffusion equation. Well, this is a big step, but I will slowly explain how you will end up with this equation. Does this equation look familiar to you, this advection diffusion equation? Sometimes seen it before in other applications, possibly. Okay, well, how do we arrive at this equation? Because this is, in fact, the kind of basic transport equation. And well, like the Navier-Stokes equation is more or less a transport equation like that, where the only difference is that we then are transporting momentum and we include pressures, but it's just a transport equation. Well, when we look at a part of the domain, and I'm now looking at just a two-dimensional situation, so to make it not too complicated, so we have horizontal axis, the x and the y axis in vertical. So we look at a certain element, flow element, with a unit width of delta x length and delta y height. And at the left side of the boundary, particles are flowing in that area with a certain velocity u, that's the horizontal velocity over the particles, and a certain concentration c. And so the total amount of material entering through the left boundary is u times c, the velocity at that location times the volumetric concentration, just the number of particles. At the other side, of course, particles are leaving. At the moment, I'm only looking at horizontal advection, so I'm neglecting vertical transport. Assume that vertical transport is zero, so no vertical velocities, only horizontal velocities. Well, at the right side, you'll see that there's, of course, material leaving as well. And there can be a gradient in that term UC. And so at the right side, you can see that what is leaving there, UC plus the gradient of that U times C times a value, times the length delta X. So this is, in fact, the total transport at the right side. If there's no gradient, so no difference in the product of u times c, that means that the ddx times uc is zero, no gradient. This term is zero, and you see that at the left side the same amount of particles are coming in, and at the right side the same amount of particles are leaving. So there's just the transport is, there's no difference in transport over the two boundaries, so there's no difference in the number of particles in this room. If we are in this room and the number of people leaving of entering through that door is equal to the number of people leaving through that door, then there's a lot of transport in this room, because there's a lot of people walking around, but the number of people is staying the same. If there's a gradient in the number of people entering and the number of people leaving, you see that the number of people is increasing or decreasing. And then this is in fact the control volume that I'm looking at. Okay, well, this, if we look at the change of concentration during time, so what is happening, because this is the number of particles, of the volume of particles in time changing, is must be equal to the difference in what's entering here and leaving there. Well, just at the left side, uc times height delta y is entering, and on the right side, delta y times this term is leaving. And that is just a volumetric balance equation. Well, we can just subtract this. You can see that the uc term drops out, because there's a positive in front of the term in brackets, and you see within the brackets the uc minus with a negative sign, so that term drops out, and you arrive finally at this simple advection equation, which states that the rate of change, so the concentration difference in time, so the increase or decrease of concentration in time, is equal to the difference in horizontal transport over a certain distance. So if there's no gradient in horizontal fluxes, because for instance the velocity is the same and the concentration is the same at the left and the right side boundaries, well, there's no change in concentration. Yes. There's several possibilities. Let's assume, for instance, that the concentration is constant over the whole area. So there's a uniform concentration in this area. If then the velocity at the left side is larger than the velocity at the right side, then you see that there will be more particles coming in than leaving. Because it's the product of u times c, which is the flux. So there's the rate of change. Let's, for instance, take this room again. If the concentration, if people are walking with a larger speed into this room, but we have the same amount of people, so every person has a distance of 1 meter, but if they're walking with a larger velocity inside of the room and leaving at a lower velocity, but everybody is at the same distance, you'll see that more people will come in. So it's the product from the velocity times concentration which determines the flux. So we can a rate of change, because the u can be varying over the x, or the concentration can be varying over the x. Only if the product of these two, u times c, is constant over the x, then you'll see that there's no change of the number of particles within time in that area. That's important to realize. It's just, and this is just, these are just the particles carried along with the flow. Because there's a flow and particles are in the flow, and the particles are dragged with the flow, you'll see that the particles will enter into the domain. So this is a very basic advection equation, because this is only horizontal advection. But you can imagine that if I will apply the whole same reasoning in vertical direction, that there will be a term d dy times u times c as well, entering in the formula. But I'm not going to repeat that. So this is advection. Now we're going to look at the influence of turbulence. What's happening with turbulence? Well, let's look again at this control volume. At the left boundary, I've plotted a lot of particles. And at the right side, there's no particles at all. And you have a kind of an eddy, a turbulent eddy, which is, well, more stirring up the flow. Well, what happens when there's a kind of an eddy busy here at the left side of the boundary? You'll see that at the left side of the boundary, there are more particles than at the right side of the boundary, at the boundary. Yeah, because there's less particles. Here the concentration in the domain is lower than the concentration just outside of the domain. Well, what happens with a turbulent eddy? You see that when there's an eddy, only one particle is moving out of the domain, while more particles, because there's more busy at the left side, more particles are getting in. So you see that there's no net flow into the boundary, because the same amount of water is entering here and leaving at the other side, because it's just more, just imagine it as a kind of a circular movement. In fact, it's not right, not exactly circular, but just to make it not too difficult. But you need a certain gradient in concentration to get transport. If there are the same number of particles at the left side and the right side of that boundary, then there will be no net transport, because the same amount of particles from the left, which are carried in through the boundary, will leave again at the other side. So you need a gradient, a difference in concentration over a horizontal distance to get real transport over that boundary. And that's a diffusion process. No gradient, no net transport. Let's again look at this room again. And there's one large eddy. Eddy is going through the door at the left side and leaving to that door at the other side. There are 20 people waiting for this door, and only 2 people waiting for him at the inner side of the room at this door. When the eddy enters, a lot of people are sucked in the room. 20 people are sucked in the room at that door. Only 2 are leaving out, and we have 18 people extra in the room. Yes. If there are the same number of people waiting there and in and out of the room, then the same people are leaving and coming in. So there's no net change in the number of people in this room. Quite simple, in fact. Well, how do we write this in terms of an equation? The transport through the left wall is equivalent with the concentration gradient, so you need a concentration difference over that wall, that is the dc dx. And that epsilon, that is a kind of a diffusion constant, that takes into account how effective that eddy is. If there's a very small turbulence, then that epsilon is low, has a low value, so there's almost no mixing. If it's a very turbulent field, then that epsilon is very effective, so a lot of mixing. It's kind of a mixing coefficient, which takes into account the effect of turbulence. So at the left side, these number of particles are entering this control volume. Well, of course, at the right side, you can look at the same transport as well. And at the right side, you will see that there is a term epsilon times dc dx. But we have to look at the gradient in the concentration gradient itself to look at the net transport. You can, from the previous slide, we have seen that it is the gradient in u times c which determined the transport, net transport. So now we have to look at the gradient, d dx, of this transport due to turbulence. So that's why you see the d dx over the transport, the previous slides, you see the ddx over uc. uc was the transport here. The ddx was the contribution in the horizontal direction. The same holds for the turbulence. This is the transport at the left side, and the ddx times that term is the difference. Well, then you can look again, what's the influence of the turbulence on the rate of the increase of concentration in the control volume, and you see that again, ddx times the volume, ddx my delta x times delta y, that's the number of particles, the volume of particles in the control volume, is equivalent to the rate of change of this transport due to diffusion or turbulence. Well, then we have identified both influences, and we can add them up. Because finally, when we just divide by delta y delta x, we are left with this equation. And if we sum them up, you see that the total, we see the first, in fact, part of the advection diffusion equation, only in the horizontal direction. Well, in the vertical direction, exactly the same is happening, and the direction in the third dimension, which is not taken into account, of course, as well. So it's easily, you can see that we can the total equation in two dimensions will be this equation, which it was the equation where I started with. And if I include the third coordinate, so the coordinate out of this plane, then the only thing which changes is that there's a ddz times wc, u is horizontal, v is vertical, and w is then the flow velocity to the third dimension, and we have an extra term which takes the influence of turbulence into account, and there's a dz times epsilon times dw dz entering into the equation. So that's all, in fact. And it's important to know that we're looking at the concentration of particles, so the u and the v in this equation are the velocities of the particles. Not interested, because we're looking at the transport equation of the volume of particles, we have to look at the concentration of particles and the velocity of particles. That's important to note. And there can be a difference, as you know, between the velocity of the fluid and the velocity of particles. The simplest example that I can give you is just when I drop one particle in a stagnant fluid, then the fluid velocity is zero, and I have a vertical velocity of the particle. And so normally these two velocities will not be the same. Okay. So when we start with this general equation, we see a lot of this shape. It's difficult to solve it. We can solve it numerically, but not analytically. There's no analytical solution. But we can simplify it a little bit with some assumptions. So one of the first approximations is that the horizontal diffusion, so the transport due to horizontal diffusion, is small compared with the horizontal advection. It means that because we have a horizontal flow through the settling basin, that's the main transport mechanism. And of course there will be some horizontal transport due to turbulence, but it is more or less small compared to the advection. So, and which terms do we compare them in this equation? What is the horizontal advection term? This one, this horizontal advection. Horizontal diffusion is this one. So this one is small compared to that one. Well, so we just drop it out. That's the first approximation. Second approximation for the ideal settling basin is that we have a stationary flow, so there's no change in time of the whole situation in the basin. So the, in fact, we assume that after some time, of course, when we start loading, there will be a change in concentration in the domain, but after some time we have a kind of a stationary situation and nothing will change anymore within time. So which terms drops out at the equation then, when it's stationary? There's no change in time anymore. Sorry? Yeah, dc dt, that's right. Okay, so that's stationary flow. Well, there's another approximation, because here we're looking at vertical, in the, you see in the equation there are vertical velocities, the value v in the second term of the equation. Well, that v is the sum, is in fact the particle velocity, and the particle velocity can be the settling velocity of the particle itself, plus, for instance, the flow velocity. If we have a vertical flow velocity, then the particle will settle with a larger speed, eh? Then when there's a stagnant, when the fluid velocity in vertical direction is zero. Assume, it can even be the case that we have a vertical velocity going up, and when that vertical velocity of the fluid is the same as the settling velocity of a particle, then that V is zero, because it's just imbalance. Well, what we assume now is that there's no vertical flow velocity in the domain, because all more or less the average flow velocity is horizontal, flow is going from left to right, and the only vertical velocity of the particles is due to the settling velocity itself. Well, and the second thing is that we assume that the settling velocity is not a function of the concentration, which in fact we know is not right, because we have a hindered settling effect that has been explained yesterday. Well, that it makes it easy, because we can then write this, because when we look at this previous term, we see that the V times C is within the within brackets, so we have to look at the gradient of the product. But if the velocity is constant, there's no gradient, so we can just get it out of the bracket. And that's why we can just remove this one and write only the concentration gradient times the settling velocity. Yes.
So basically, V and U are like relative velocity of the particle
with the. No, U is the actual. U and V are the actual particle velocities. But if the vertical fluid velocity is zero, so in fact you can see that we have a when there's a when we have a velocity field going down, that is for instance the V water, that's the vertical velocity, and then we have a particle which is settling with a settling speed relatively to the moving water. Then the actual particle velocity, V, is V water plus the settling velocity. Well, in the transport equation we are using this one. But if I assume that the water velocity is zero in vertical direction, this one is zero, and then V equals WS. Good question that you asked it, that I could explain it a little bit better. Okay. Then we have an extra simplification, and then we're looking at this term, because here you see that there's still a possibility that the U, the horizontal velocity, can change over the horizontal coordinate. Well, we assume now that the U is constant as well in the whole domain, so U is just uniform and just one value no matter where you are in the domain, in the basin. There's so no no velocity distribution or whatever. Well, that's easy as well, because then we can take this one at the equation as well. And we can write it like that. And u is now the average horizontal flow velocity in the domain. Well, that is, we are almost there. The last simplification is in the third term. Because you see that within the brackets is still a variation of the diffusion coefficient possible. So the diffusion coefficient can still be a function of the vertical coordinate, which is in fact always the case, because very near to the bottom, very near to the bed, the eddies are quite small, so there's less turbulent mixing than when I'm higher up in the basin, then the eddies are much bigger. So in reality, that diffusion coefficient, that mixing coefficient, is indeed a function of the vertical coordinate. Low, small at the bottom, small at the water surface, and largest, well, theoretically the largest value will be around in the middle of the basin from the bed. Well, this is another simplification. Say, okay, the diffusion is just a constant average value in the domain. And then I finally arrive at this simplified advection diffusion equation, which you might have had in one of your mathematics courses on separation of variables or partial differential equations. Did you ever follow the courses on partial differential equations? Because this is a very popular equation to solve in that field. And you can solve it by separation of variables. So you assume that the C is a function of the product of a function of something only variable in X and something only in Y, and you, well, introduce it in this equation, and then you get two normal partial normal differential equations, and you get a solution in a kind of series like solution. I'm not going to do it, but only look at what will be then the result of such a calculation. Now, what we see then, if we apply such a when we solve the equation, we see that when we, for instance, have a situation where we have a very nice homogeneous concentration over the height in the entrance section, and we and the particles are transported to the right, you see that due to the settling effect, the concentration will be, the total concentration will be lower at the end, because the particles are just, well, being removed from the flow and settling in the bed. And at the same time, we'll see that there will be less particles near the water surface and more particles near the bed, due to the settling. So that will be the solution. And how can we then determine the overflow loss? Well, we know that at the entrance section, the total volume of particles is u times the height times the inflowing concentration. That's the total sand flux going in at the left side. At the right side, the total volume of particles is the horizontal flow velocity, which is a constant, so I can put it outside of the integral, and I integrate the concentration over height. So the integrated concentration over height times the horizontal velocity is the number of volume of particles, yes.
So it's also assumed that the velocity of the flow at the end of the basin is still u.
Yeah. That is one of the assumptions that was... This assumption, this term, yes. Here you see that the horizontal velocity is a function of the, can be a function of the x coordinate, and so that's why dx times the term, And now we have said, okay, we simplify it and we say the horizontal flow velocity is everywhere the same in horizontal direction and in vertical direction, so uniform flow over the whole domain. And that's why we can just put the u as a constant in front of this ddx. This is one of the simplifications, which is not, in fact, not the case, but it's just a simplified model. Otherwise, we cannot solve it. Well, when we have a stationary situation, the volume in is equal to volume out. Eh? So that is, that's then the case. Eh? So Q in is Q out, but then still the flow velocity can vary. For instance, in the inflow section, you can have a very low velocity over a large height, and at the overflow sections, you can have a high velocity over a small depth. Eh? So there can be a change in velocity, and that in reality that will be the case. But in this ideal settling basin, we have said, okay, we have an entrance section and we have an overflow section, and we're not going to model what's happening over there. That's too complicated. The only thing that we're concentrating on is the middle section, where we define it as the settling section. And in the settling section, we say that we assume that the horizontal flow velocity is equal. Everywhere is uniform. Okay. So when we calculate the overflow, we integrate the concentration over height, then we know the volume of particles leaving, and then the removal. Efficiency is then just the amount of particle settling, and there's a difference between coming in and out over the amount of particles going in. Well, and because we have an analytical solution of the partial differential equation, we can really calculate this effect, and the result of these calculations can be shown in a graph where we see the removal ratio, that is. So the efficiency of the number of particles settling in the bed as a function of the turbulence. Well, in this case, in the horizontal scale, you see the influence of the turbulence, where from when we go to the left, you see that the increase in turbulence is larger, or the influence of turbulence is larger. The right side, there's no turbulence. At the right side here, you can see that the effect for when there's... So here you see the effect of that influence here you see the effect of the turbulence on the total ratio. When there's no turbulence at all, when we go to the right side, you see that all the lines are approaching the normal values of removal ratio of 0.1 until 0.9. When the influence of turbulence is increasing, you see that these lines are dropping and less particles are indeed settling. When the line is dropping, you see that less particles are removed from the flow, and this is the whole stirring up behavior of the of the turbulence. Well, this whole analysis was already done in 1946 or 1948 or something like that. This is quite old theory, and that's why, because they didn't have strong computers or no computers at all at the moment, and that's why they derived an analytical solution. Now we can just solve the whole equation just with a numerical method. Okay. So if we go back again to the whole settling process, so far we didn't look at the effect of the flow velocity on the sedimentation itself. In the even we took into account the influence of turbulence. The influence of turbulence stirs up the particles, and that means that particles are longer in suspension, yes?
Does that also mean that when particles already have settled, that they will be picked up again?
Yeah, that's possible in theory. But what we see in practice is that the effect of the flow velocity near the bed will have a reducing effect on the sedimentation velocity itself. And so, for instance, imagine that I have a glass of water and sand particles, and I mix it up, and I just put it down, then I don't have any flow velocity, horizontal flow velocity in that container, and the particles will just settle, and you see the bed coming up as a function of time. Then you have the sedimentation, and you can calculate the sedimentation velocity just with this equation, where E is zero. Eh? So there's no pickup by turbulence because there's no horizontal flow in that glass. Another extreme situation is when you look at a pipeline transport of particles. Then you have a very large horizontal flow velocity. All the time particles try to settle on the bottom of the pipeline because they're just settling. But at the same time, the turbulence within the pipeline is stirring the particles up again from the pipeline bottom. And then you'll see that E is, well, more or less equal to S, and there's no sedimentation velocity at all. Now, that is another extreme situation. Yeah? The pipeline transport above the critical velocity, you don't have any sedimentation. Well, in between, you have an area where there is influence. Yeah? So if I, for instance, if I make a graph and I put on the horizontal the flow velocity, horizontal flow velocity, and flow velocity zero, and this is the sedimentation velocity. Dus when I stir up a mixture, I'll get a certain sedimentation velocity in the glass. Yeah? Well, for a certain flow velocity, you'll see that it won't settle anymore, because the turbulence in the pipeline is just stirring up the particles at the whole time, and they're settling, but there's no net sedimentation. I have a point over here. Yeah? That is the U critical. In pipeline transport. Well, and there's then a kind of a relation. And when we see from tests that we did, you see that it looks like that. So for low velocities, you don't see too much influence of the velocity near the bed on the sedimentation velocity. And after some time, this will drop down quite dramatically. This, well, value is a little bit depending on the particle size, and but for instance, for, well, 150 microns, this will be around 0.5 meters per second, and this will be around, well, maybe 2.5 meters per second or something like that, to get an idea. Well, in hopper sedimentation, we're always in, well, this region. Because if we would be around here or there, there won't be any sedimentation at all. And then we're loading too fine particles, or the hopper size is just too small for the discharge that we're putting in the hopper. And so for practical well, the practical applications, this is the interesting area where we will look at for hopper sedimentation. So we have always will have a situation where we have sedimentation, because otherwise we cannot load the hopper. So you're always left of that critical velocity, but there can be an influence on of that flow velocity near the bed. And sometimes they use it scour or erosion, but in fact it's not erosion, it's more kind of a hindered settling near the bed. The sedimentation velocity is decreasing due to the effect of the horizontal flow. But if we're talking about scour or we're talking about erosion, then the bed will go down. Yeah?
What is scour?
Scour is, well, just when you have a scour is more or less a type of erosion. For instance, a bridge pier or a windmill pile in the seabed, and you have wave and currents along that pile, you see that there's always a kind of a hole in the seabed is created due to the higher flow velocities near that obstacle. That's called scour. And very often people use this hindered sedimentation due to the bed shear stress. They call it scour as well, but it's not really a good expression because, well, finally the bed will still come up. There will be always net sedimentation in the hopper in practical situations. Of course, in theory it can be possible that you first, for instance, start loading the hopper with a very low velocity and you have a settling bed and the bed goes up, and then after some time you increase the velocity enormously and decrease the concentration, and then you can blow all the sand out of the hopper again, of course. Then you would have real erosion. But yeah, in practical situations we'll never do that. Okay, we'll have a short break and then continue at 11:45. Well, let's continue. So the sedimentation, we know now that the sedimentation velocity is influenced by the flow velocity near the bed. It's reduced, in fact. We never get the situation where E is larger than S, because then we just will blow out all the sand out of the hopper. So normally E, during hopper sedimentation, E will always be smaller than S. But there can be an influence of that flow velocity. How can we determine the sediment pickup? How can we determine the influence? Well, first we have to know the flow velocity in the hopper, especially near the bed, because the flow velocity near the bed will influence that sedimentation. And secondly, we like to have then a relationship between that erosion or hindered sedimentation, which is in fact a better definition, the bed shear stress, the particle size distribution, the concentration. If we know first the flow velocity and then the relationship, then we can determine the value of E. Well, one of the problems is that the situation in a hopper is quite different than we encounter in nature, like in river flows or on the waves, sand transport, due to two effects, especially that the concentration near the bed in the hopper is much higher than you will normally see in natural conditions. You can never have a 30% concentration near the bed with a very low flow velocity in nature. Maybe when you have a very large avalanche in the water, where a lot of material is more or less eroded, then something can happen like that. But normally you'll only have very small concentrations near the bed. So we really have to look at the specific situations in dredging to find suitable relationships. Well, the first methods or the first models assume a uniform or a logarithmic velocity profile. So when we start loading, we have a certain water depth. The discharge is distributed over the height, so we have an average flow velocity, and during time the sand bed will come up. There's less space available for flow, so the flow velocity is increasing on average. And most simple models are based on these kind of assumptions. So you just assume that the total height of the hopper is used by the flow. And when then the sand bed goes up, there's less space available. Well, then we can, for instance, look at it vertical of the horizontal flow velocity, and you can compute a certain critical speed. For a certain critical flow velocity, particles will not settle anymore. Or you can compute then a critical diameter, which is not settling anymore, depending on the horizontal flow velocity. So a larger flow will result in a larger particle that still can settle. That's in fact the Kemp approach. Well, and you can, for a certain flow velocity, you can then determine a certain particle size that will not settle anymore. And it means that if we then look at the integral of Kemp, there is a certain size, PS, and it is in the lower side, and that will not settle anymore due to that hindered sedimentation, due to the effect of the bed shear stress. So this is more or less a Kemp approach, and this is the Miedema approach to take the flow velocity into account. In practice, we see that in fact there is not too much influence of this flow velocity, and it's due to two effects. So if you try to get, if you are using this method to calculate the critical particle size that doesn't settle anymore, and introduce it in the Kemp integral and look at the results that you'll get, you'll see that there's only very little influence on the settling behavior. And why is that? That's because of that uniform flow assumption or logarithmic flow assumption, and you assume that the whole flow is distributed over the whole height. You will see that the horizontal flow velocity is only very small, so the maybe 10 centimeters per second, that kind of value you get. And when you look at the influence, you'll see that you're around here somewhere. So very low flow velocity will have a very small influence on that hindered sedimentation effect. So you see effect during the whole stage. You won't see any influence apart from the very last moment where you have a very limited water depth, and then you get very high flow velocities, but then your hopper is almost already completely filled with sand, and so there's no influence. Well, when we look at the Kemp model and see what's really happening in the model, we see something like that. The mixture is entering from left to right. Here we see the flow velocity. We see a very nice uniform flow velocity. That is what we assumed. So everywhere the flow velocity is around about the same value. And here we enter the concentration nicely distributed over the total height of the hopper. And in the Kemp model, this is just the application of the Kemp model, what I did here, just a numerical simulation. And you see that due to settling, the whole surface of this mixture will go down. It's just settling. Okay, but this is in fact quite strange, because what we see over here is we have a length of only 40 meters, a height of 2 meters, and we see that the top of this concentrated mixture, here's the concentration, that's 0.2. That's a mixture of about 1300 kilogram per cubic meters. Blue is around 1000 kilogram per cubic meters. So we have a quite large difference in density, and we have a sloping surface of that dense fluid. And that's strange. If you've ever been near a border of a lake, you see a water surface which has a density of 1000 kilogram per cubic meter. Above the lake there's air, about 1 kilogram per cubic meter. And the horizontal, you see that the lake has a very nice horizontal surface. Now we have a large difference in density as well. And we see a very sloping surface. It's impossible in practice. This cannot happen. Because it's just a heavy fluid. If you have two fluids, one heavy fluid and a less heavier fluid on top, why should there be a sloping surface? No, because this is not sand, this is a mixture of sand and water, it's not settled sand. What you see over here is not settled sand, it's a mixture, a heavy mixture of particles and water, but still a fluid. 1.3. 20% concentration is around 1.3 ton per cubic meter or 1300 kilogram per cubic meter. And water is 1000, so it's very heavy compared with fluid. And why is this? In the model this is happening. Why? Because we have assumed that there is a horizontal flow velocity, and we didn't couple the concentration resulting from that assumed flow velocity, assumed velocity field. So there's no coupling between the density calculated by the diffusion equation, the advection diffusion equation, with the actual flow, but of course there should be a coupling. When there's a, because this surface won't be in this horizontal direction due to gravity. And now I'll show you the same experiment, numerical experiment. So I will release at the left side the same amount of concentration particles with the same velocity. So at the left side of the hopper we have indeed a uniform flow velocity with a uniform concentration, but in the remaining part of the hopper there is an influence of this concentration distribution on the actual flow velocities that will develop. And then you'll get this. Situation. It's totally different. You see that due to the high density difference, the mixture drops to the bottom and now it starts filling up like a heavy fluid. And we don't see any uniform flow velocity in the hopper at all. We see a very high flow velocity near the bed over here. You see the mixture going down, a kind of circulation is taking place. And this is when we have an actual coupling between the sediment transport equation and the momentum equation. And so the actual flow velocities in the hopper during loading are not uniform. Let's show it again. So the big density wave, it bounces at the other side of the hopper, and a big wave is kind of a wave, a density wave is moving back again. There's still no sedimentation, there's still fluid as you can see, there's no bed developing, but the heavy fluid is more or less with a very nice horizontal surface, more or less filling up the domain with the heavy fluid. This is just high flow velocity. This is velocity, so we have 1 meters per second near the bed of flow velocity. And here you see kind of a circular, well, kind of an eddy developing. And this is the whole filling up with the mixture.
And I would say that the velocity that we have spotted in the top graph should be more higher to the eddy zone of the second picture.
Now here's the you have a uniform horizontal inflow section, so the horizontal flow velocity is equal. And then due to the density, the mixture accelerates to the in vertical direction due to gravity. You see in here a nice high velocity, then it more or less is bends off due to the bed. It has to go through this bend. You get a high velocity and then it distributes again. And you're filling up this hopper with the heavy fluid. You see the surface of the fluid just going up during time. I'll show you another animation a little bit later. Well, this is these are the model tests that we carried out to check this theory. Done by Deltares, a laboratory a little bit further on the Rotterdamseweg. You can see a top view with the diffuser that we used to introduce the mixture, so we had a nice two-dimensional flow distribution. And but you can see all those vertical pipes that you see at the bottom end of the pipe. There was a device to measure the flow velocity in the hopper, so we could measure the direction of the flow in two directions. And at the same time we measured the concentration on about 14 different locations. So we had, I think, 13 locations where we measured velocities and about 40 positions where we measured density to look how this hole is developing. Here another view seen from the entrance section. Total length of about 12 meters, 3 meter wide, 2.5 meter deep. There's another, we tested other inflow mechanisms as well. This is a kind of a pipe. So the previous one is a very nice diffuser, where we have a better horizontal distribution over the horizontal axis than this pipe. But there was, during these model tests, little influence on this, the type of inflow construction. Well, this is then the actual flow pattern already seen on the simulations. This is what we really measured as well. And this is the measured flow velocity in time. And I have to explain this a little bit. What you see over here are two signals. At the bottom, you see a measured flow velocity, horizontal flow velocity. And what we did was we started with the measurement device near the original bed of the hopper. It was measuring the horizontal flow velocity. Then we started filling the hopper, and then the sand bed comes up, and after some time the instrument is buried in the sand. And so we kept the velocity measurement on the same vertical position, but because of the bed moving up, then you'll see that the more or less are measuring through the whole density current until the moment that is buried in the sand, and that is this moment here. You see that the flow velocity is increasing and then it drops to zero, then it's into the sand bed. And what we then did, we lifted the instrument again. It starts measuring and then it's buried again. But with this method you are more or less measuring through the whole density current, because you're making a kind of a profile with the assumption that the flow velocity is more or less constant in time, of course. And now what you can see is very interesting. You see that at the start of this test, when the instrument was still quite deep, you see quite high flow velocities. Then the velocity goes down, and then the velocity goes up again. So first you see the highest velocities you see at the beginning of the loading process and at the end of the loading process. Well, at the end of the loading process, that's due to the fact that you only have indeed limited space available because the hopper is almost completely filled. The high velocity at the start of the filling process is that density current, what you saw on the animation, that the flow velocity near the bed had the highest value, very nicely. And what you see over here is the vertical position of the instrument. So we started here at about 1.2 meters, then we lifted it up again, up again, up again. And the blue line is the measured sand bed level on that location. So you see every time that when the velocity drops to zero, you see that the sand bed is at that location. And then they waited for some small time. It was buried maybe a few centimeters under the bed, and then they lifted again. It started measuring. Here it drops to zero again. Here it drops to zero again. Here it drops to zero again. Every time you see when the sand bed, the measured sand bed, crosses the vertical position of the instrument, you see that the velocity goes to zero because it's in the sand bed. And what you can see is that the actual flow velocity, what we measured, the maximum flow velocity is this red line. This is another example. While in the original uniform flow distribution, when we would assume that the flow would be uniform and nicely distributed over the whole hopper, you would expect this flow velocity. So we see that the uniform flow velocity is completely different from what we actually measured, and in fact what we calculate as well when we have a model where the sediment transport equations are coupled to the momentum equations. And so that are the shortcomings from the Kemp approach, because we prescribe the flow field, but in reality we have density currents, we have an influence of the bed shear stress on sedimentation, we have the inflow and outflow zone, which are in fact not modeled on the Kemp model, because we only are concentrating on the settling zone. But nevertheless, you'll see that the Kemp model does give a quite reasonable estimate for the sedimentation and loading time. And that's due to the effect that the influences of the overflow positions and the inflow conditions are more or less second order effects. The most important parameters are that loading, hopper loading parameter. So the discharge over the width and length of the hopper and the settling velocity of the particles. These are the two most dominant effects on hopper sedimentations, and these two are, well, available, are introduced in the Kemp approach. But if you like to have, well, more, if you like to do some more fundamental research and what's really the influence on of the loading positions, and or should we start with the hopper filled with hopper water or not, that kind of influences, you need a better model. And well, that's why I in fact derived a two-dimensional model, where in the Kemp model we had uncoupled the sediment transport equations and the momentum equations, and now we're going to couple it. And you couple, what you then do is solve the Navier-Stokes equations in the hopper in two dimensions. I introduced the mixture model, so no multi-phase flow. So more or less you regard the fluid as a mixture and not a separate. So you don't solve the separate equations for the solid phase and the fluid phase. It's in hydrodynamic model, so not hydrostatic. And you have that coupling between the momentum equations and the sediment transport equations, what I've already showed you. And that's why you get that buoyancy effect. Density currents only will develop when you have that coupling between momentum equations and sediment transport equations. Well, to solve this Reynolds averaged model, the Rons, you need to model the turbulence and I did it with a K epsilon turbulence model. I'll go a bit quickly through the details. I don't know why it's not. Working again. Other important condition is that, of course, you need to have a movable bed in the hopper because you like to really fill up the hopper. So the bed should move to the computational domain. You need an erosion sedimentation boundary condition at the hopper, and you like to introduce not one particle size but the whole particle size distribution. And when you look at that, you get it. The total model is more or less built up by three different blocks. You have the Navier-Stokes equation solved. You have the turbulence model and the sediment transport equations. Well, here you recognize the Kemp model, but for every fraction. So, for instance, if I divide the particle size distribution in 10 different particle sizes, I'm solving 10 different sediment transport equations, in fact 10 kind of Kemp models. But the only thing is that here we don't assume that the flow velocity is uniform. No, the flow velocity is coming from the Navier-Stokes equations. But the Navier-Stokes equation is influenced by the density distributions coming out of the sediment transport equations. And the turbulence model is giving the eddy viscosity, and the turbulence model is again influenced by the sediment transport equation as well. Because if you have a high density near the bed and a low density above the bed, a turbulent eddy will be damped to that vertical gradient in density, stratification influence. That will be the same in atmospheric flows. Well, when you solve it, you can calculate the flow velocities. Here you see simulations with different levels of the bed with different velocity profiles, and here again you see that the maximum flow velocity measured in during time is highest when we start loading and highest when we stop loading. The same phenomena that we have measured in the calculations. Concentration distribution, and here you see a nice animation of a loading of a hopper, where you see in fact all effects at the same time. Density currents building up, sand bed building up. You can see that the loading position is varying, and this is well more or less a simulation of what could happen during the loading process. So here we have more or less a complete two-dimensional simulation of the loading process in the hopper. And this model is now used. I made it for my PhD, and after my PhD I more or less made it foolproof, and it is now currently used in Boscaas and Van Oort, when they try to optimize hopper sizes for new hoppers. They are really using this model. Okay. Another very simple model to show you, which can give a first approximate solution for the overflow loss, is based on a very simple balance of sediment, where we say, okay, the overflow loss is in fact the function of the inflowing sediment flux and the what is the amount of particles going in over the amount of particles settling in the bed? Well, we recognize this equation again. So the sedimentation velocity is the sedimentation minus erosion or hindered sedimentation over this the 1 minus the porosity times the concentration near the bed. If I look then at the ratio between the sedimentation flux, so the amount of particles settling in the bed, over the amount of particles going in, we can derive this formula where you see that the ratio is equivalent with the ingoing concentration And here you see the erosion term. And here you see the hopper load parameter, the Kemp influence effect. So this is in fact the Kemp influence, the overflow rate. And this is kind of a correction factor to take into account that the concentration in the hopper is not is varying. Well, for a simple situation where the erosion or hindered sedimentation is zero, so there's no influence on the flow velocity near the bed, you can simplify it even further, and then you see that we can define a kind of a parameter, hopper loading parameter, S star, which is the ratio between the ingoing sand flux over the sand flux settling in the bed, and you can write it as a function of something of the concentration and bed porosity times the kind of dimensionless hopper load parameter. So the hopper load parameter over the settling velocity. Well, we can look at the experiments if we can really find such a relationship, because now I like to find a relationship between overflow loss and this settling flux parameter, the S star. And what I did was I'll first go to the next graph, put them in a graph. Here you see all the tests that we did, the model tests. Here you see the S star parameter and vertically the overflow loss cumulative measured during the experiments. And indeed, we see that there is a relationship between the overflow loss and the S star parameter. And you see that the relationship between S star and overflow loss is better than I only would take the H star, and the H star is the dimensionless overflow rate, more or less the Kemp parameter. Well, that's encouraging, but you have to be quite careful with this approach, because this is based on model tests, and there is a scale effect during the tests. Because we scale down the hopper, you'll see that the erosion or the hindered sedimentation process is not on the right scale compared with the full size hoppers. So in model tests, you'll always find that the hindered sedimentation is less compared with the actual situation. It's very difficult, because you are dealing with two contradicting scale laws. You have the fruit scale, which is necessary to get the whole sedimentation process and the settling process and the density currents on the right scale. And the situation near the bed, where you have that hindered settlement, is more or less more related to a Reynolds type of scale. And these two scale laws are more or less fighting with each other. So if you have the one scale the right, then the whole flow is not right. So the only thing that you can do is really measure, and then you can validate the models on lab scale. And if the whole physical process is right in your equations, then you can use it to scale up the whole your calculation. But it's difficult or a little bit dangerous to scale up the just directly the model results with this approach. So this can be used for a first approximate, but you have to be careful. Okay, now I'll give you a simple example how to calculate a overflow loss just using the Kemp method. And we do it, so in fact we're going to solve that integral, but now with a simple numerical approximation. Let's assume that we have a hopper with a certain length, certain width. Before he was in that, now that was the old situation, now there's a section of about 30 meters, 50 meters inserted. So they cut it in two and they build a piece in between. This is the old situation, we have a certain discharge that is still the same. And let's assume that we have this particle size distribution. And so this is the cumulative distribution of the size of particles that we're going to dredge. And so we, you see that about 100% is around, well, 2 to 3 millimeters. Or everything is smaller than that. Okay, what we can do, make just a simple spreadsheet. The first thing that we calculate is with the length, the width and the discharge Q, we can calculate that V0. That's just Q divided over L times B. That's the overflow rate. So we see that the overflow rate is about, well, 8 millimeters per second. That can be seen as an average vertical flow velocity through the hopper. Well, from the particle size distribution that I showed you in the previous graph, I distributed in in 10 different sections over here. And every particle size has about 10% of the total volume of particles. So I cut the whole size in 10 different fractions with different particles sizes. So 10% has a diameter of 0.01 millimeter and 10% has 3.3 millimeter and so on. Well, for every diameter particle size, I can calculate the settling velocity, W0, and just using the formulas that I gave you yesterday, right, you can just introduce it in your spreadsheet. You can, for instance, use that empirical equation. So for every size, I have settling velocity. You see that for the largest fraction, the 3.3 millimeter, will settle with a velocity of about 0.3 meter per second, 30 centimeters per second, while the very fine size is only settling at about 0.6 millimeters per second. So the very large difference in settling velocities. Okay, well, the Kemp integral integrates this settling velocity over it's the integral over Vs Ws over V null over times Vs dp. So the integrated. So we can, for every fraction, we can calculate then the ratio between W, the settling velocity of one particle, and that overflow rate. It's just this column divided by that column. We get a new column again. And this determines then the removal ratio of that particle size. So what does that mean? This column means, take for instance column number or row number 3. You see here a value of 0.87 appearing for a size of about 100 microns, 0.11 millimeter. That means that from this fraction, so these particles, about 80% of the particles will settle in the hopper. While for the smaller particles, the 50 micron particles, only 19% or 20% are settling, and from the very the small size, that was the 60 microns, only, well, 0.07 the fraction will settle. That is 0.7% will settle. And you see values of 1 in all other rows. Why is that? Why is there a 1? It always settles. Of course, this value removal ratio can never be 41, because there cannot be 400% settling of the number of particles flowing in. So therefore we have to reduce that value to 1. Now that means that from everything above around 100 microns, everything will settle. That means that this this part, this 10% of this size will settle, etc., etc., etc. And we can just sum up the total removal ratio of the whole particle size distribution. And we see that 80% of the total inflowing particle size distribution will settle in the hopper. Well, the overflow loss is 1 minus the removal ratio per definition. That means that we have about 20% of overflow loss. And this is an example where we don't have, we didn't take into account the hindered settling effect, because we are basing this equation not on the WS value, the settling velocity of more than one particle, but only on one particle. So the next graph, I think that's I have in it, yeah, we'll see that we assume a inflow concentration of 0.17. The V0 is of course the same value, that's just the Q over B times the width. But now you see that the settling velocity is now calculated including the hindered settling effect, with the formulas of yesterday, with the 1 minus c to the power n, n is a function of the particle Reynolds number. You see that the settling velocities are a little bit lower compared with the settling velocities of the previous slide, because of the hindered settling effect. But the same, we just take the ratio again between the settling velocity and the V0, only now we take the hindered settling into account, so we get Vs over V0. And well, we see that the removal ratio can again be derived. We reduce or we limit the value to 1, so values in this column larger than 1, I just put the 1. We sum up the whole removal ratio again, and we find out that the removal ratio is a little bit less. We see now that the overflow loss is increasing to almost 30% due to hindered settlement. So this is a very simple application. That is in fact how the Kemp model works, and not taking into account the hindered erosion effect or turbulence. That's the most simple application, but just to show you how it works. And if you do it like that, you'll see that the actual situation will not be far off from what you calculate over here. So it's a very good approximation. Well, you can, it's in fact the same procedure. You can, using this method, you can calculate which part of the inflowing particle size distribution will settle in the hopper, and at the same time you can calculate which part of the fraction is moving out of the hopper, and that's why by this method you can then calculate the particle size distributions in the hopper and in the overflow. When you, for instance, look at this graph, you see that this is the particle size distribution on the seabed, and what we are sucking up and pumping into the hopper. You'll see this is the particle size distribution which is actually in the hopper itself, which is settled. And this is the particle size distribution that you will see in the overflow. And you see very clearly that the particle size distribution in the hopper is coarser than what we are sucking in, because we more or less are getting rid of the fine particles. And that's why a hopper is in fact a very nice instrument to improve the particle size distribution, because you see that more or less all the fine material that we have over here is gone. Especially this amount of material you don't like on the reclamation site, the fines. So the hopper is more or less acting as a very nice big sieve, getting rid of all the fines so that you can get the coarser material on site. Of course, there are limitations. You have to know where you can leave all the fines. In the borrow area, of course, you have to look at the environmental aspects. But that's why, was one of the reasons why hoppers are so efficient for reclamation purposes. Okay, well, something about optimal loading time, but I'll continue with that on the next presentation, or the next course will be in the beginning of January. Yeah. So the remaining course will be on this, a little bit on the hopper sedimentation process. And then the other topic that I'd like to talk about you next year is on the breaching process. So final one. So that's it for this year. And well, have a nice...